part of getting you primed that as Glen comes up, people are interested for perspective on looking at quality wells and this, because the reason the series is called a regional response to infrastructure liability is because the 80-20 rule, or is it the 20-80 rule, Wally? Because that's what really what the regional team is really trying to encourage with it, as our many municipalities, which is when you put something in the ground or build anything above ground, whatever it may be, that initial capital cost represents 20% of the ultimate life cycle cost. So that's the issue. I guess that's why we have representation on a number of local grounds here today. But I also want to make one other comment before I head off to Mr. Brown, is that we have actually quite a mix in this audience. We do have a little government, we do have the development community and Kip and a couple of your colleagues, consultants, and the stewardship sector. Rich Ross Peterson. He's registered. Oh, there, right. So again, just a complete spectrum. So Glen. Sustainable service delivery.
Thank you, Kim. So the significance of this slide is that I guess it's twofold. One is I'm Glen with Glen. More importantly, this is the first time in, since 2001 that we've had a cabinet shuffle and rework, and our name hasn't changed. Although it has changed 8 times, and we have our 7th minister since 2008. But she is actually a new old minister. So. I found it quite interesting because, considering I actually finally finished my presentation last night at about 11 p.m. It's amazing how much it is in alignment with what's already been said today. So, and the other thing I wanted to say before I get started, I'm really encouraged with what's going on in the Comox Valley with CAVI and regional ops. It's really something that I say a lot. It's about alignment and aligning some of the provincial and our ministry goals, aligning those with sort of local goals and individual goals. When you have that alignment, quite often you have some really good action on the ground. So very impressed and encouraged, and as I've always said, our ministry is more than happy to participate and continue to do so. So the provincial perspective, as seen through my eyes, and probably more correctly our ministry's perspective, a lot of the programs that we're involved with local government are taken for some of the provincial initiatives and strategies that are obviously represent higher level goals, objectives and outcomes. What they do is, to some degree, they challenge the status quo. They make us think a little bit differently. They make us take responsibility. That's another thing that I like to say quite a bit is, a lot of what we're doing actually boils down to being a shared responsibility, right? It's not a provincial responsibility. It's not a local government responsibility. It's not a developer responsibility. It's not an individual responsibility. But it's all our responsibilities, right? So everyone has to take responsibility for this change. Of course, the other piece is, the baseline for this is the provincial legislation. I think it's important to note that that's the minimal accepted standard in many cases. That's not what we're really trying to achieve, or that sort of set the baseline. That's what you got to do. We're trying to go beyond that. Some of that legislation, of course, I think that was identified, is enabling, right? Bill 27 sort of sets out some ways to actually go beyond what is accepted or status quo. So how does this sort of relate to at least some of the program area that I'm involved with? So I'm involved quite a bit with the capital grant program that we provide to local governments. And one of our philosophies is these aren't ministry programs, but the provincial programs. And so we try to integrate all those higher level initiatives and strategies into our programs. And that integration occurs. There's some of the things that are integrated, and we're really going to be talking about asset management, full cost account a little bit more. But for those of you that are from local government that have applied, recognizing that water conservation is a big piece in how you manage the resource. how do we integrate them? We integrate them into the program criteria, so sometimes it's eligibility criteria, sometimes it's evaluation criteria, and sometimes it's the conditions of the contract. So if you're successful with getting a grant, we'll quite often put in conditions on that transfer or agreement or that contract. That sort of is our attempt in trying to raise the bar a little bit. So here's just some of the criteria or some of the things that we're looking at when we do reviews, so our evaluation. The encouraging thing or the exciting thing for me, and particularly that's happening right now, is I think that Judy identified how our silos, believe it or not, the province has been silos as well. Right? So I know that's hard to believe. But even within our department, our local government department, we've got a planning branch, we've got a finance branch, actually, which I'm responsible for, and an infrastructure and engineering branch, which also comes under my responsibility. We're actually seeing a bit of an integration, and we've got our planning folks who are actually looking at some legislation, and the legislation under for OCPs, and they're asking us, what do we need to do with the OCP legislation to improve that with respect to infrastructure and service delivery. So we're starting to work together, we're starting to have the same rules and measures as we move forward. So these sort of criteria, that there's incremental growth within every program, and like I said, we're moving incrementally to try to raise the bar, and ultimately, the goal for us is to add value for every dollar spent. So leveraging change, this is sort of how we operate, how one program goes to the next. It is an incremental step forward. Underneath the programs is our real attempt to try to reward to management, right? Reward good behavior instead of bad behavior. I think it started with my mentor here, Eric Bonnet. So he was my boss when I started at Municipal Affairs. Of course, it was only Municipal Affairs for one day. I started on election day. And I kept my head down and said, but I think that's where it started, with sort of looking at how these grant programs operated and understanding that quite often we were actually rewarding poor management from local governments, right? You let your infrastructure deteriorate to the point where you're in non-compliance. You come and ask for some money, you get it, you go build it, and then 25 years later, 15 years later, 3 years, you come back and ask for some more. We're saying, that's not how it's not gonna fly anymore. So talking a little bit about the infrastructure gap, the deficit, the liability, what do we know? I think this comes from, the MRSA paper, that was the SCM paper, 2007. What do we know? We know our infrastructure is old. I think there's a report card coming out, or has it come out from SCM, that has looked at some of the municipal infrastructure. But we do know our infrastructure is old. What have we done to try to replace or redo that infrastructure? So this is a little slide that we put together. So it talks about just the standard depreciation of infrastructure. The blue line sort of represents, so I always I break it down, maybe it's overly simplistic, but there's two gaps that exist in our infrastructure. There's a gap that exists because we haven't operated, maintained, replaced our infrastructure, right? So it deteriorates over time, and we let it deteriorate. Maybe we don't put enough money back into it to maintain that service level that we're trying to achieve. The other gap is that when we have new legislation that sets the standards a little bit higher. It's hard to plan for that, and I've always argued that is actually the goal for our grant programs, right? We shouldn't be funding projects that are dealing with the bottom part. responsibility to operate a museum, just like you have a car or a house, right? But you can't plan for that new standard. And then talking about what I talked about before, if you're actually building above the standard, then you've already covered off that gap. Is there anything else you want to say? So, you know, when it comes to development of new infrastructure, I think, you know, we start to have some huge opportunities, you know, and, you know, talking about sort of, as we get into talking about sort of building with nature and the services nature provides as well, is that, you know, you start talking about some things that actually appreciate instead of appreciate over time. And, you know, where's the value in that? How to provide some services? And ultimately, you know, identifying a level of service for any particular service that you're providing, but at a lower cost. So sustainable service delivery. Apparently, Kim said I said that.
You did say that.
So what is it? I mean, for me, it starts with the definition of asset management. So this is the definition that was provided by the National Asset Management Working Group. Wally in the back there was part of that group. I think traditionally, though, when we look at asset management, it is weak in a couple of areas. One is it is particularly weak, I think, in the land use planning side of things. So if you sort of expand the term I think asset management, if you look at it within many local governments right now, it starts when the asset's already built. Right? That's when asset management kicks in. I think it reduces the value that asset management and sustainable services can provide. The other thing is, you know, when that happens, I think you actually end up reducing the value that can be provided for environmental. I think that's a couple of the shortfalls. And sustainable service delivery. So I'm just going to talk about a couple of the principles about behind asset management. And principle number one, and I'm only going to talk about three, there's actually six of them. But I think for this the context of today, three is probably gets us where we want to get to. But it's all about the service. Too often, it's focused on infrastructure, right? It's not about infrastructure. Right? Infrastructure. I drove by a piece of infrastructure today. Is there anyone here from Yeah, so I drove past a piece of infrastructure that was just built. Great piece of infrastructure. Does it provide a service? No. It's an overpass that goes to nowhere. You know, I hate to, if I'm going to, you know, focus on local government, I must well focus on the province too. On Monday, I went through a piece of infrastructure that was supposed to be improving the level of service. My God, you have to go online and understand how to get through that. So has anyone gone to the McTavish for a look overpass? It is a scary piece of infrastructure. You know,
it's not a hazard.
It's an engineering marvel is what it is. But does it actually improve or provide a good service is the question, right? So anyway, it is about the service, it's not about the infrastructure, right? And, you know, the bullet below, and this is why I sort of crossed out to the public, is because you know, I think there's some concerns with the interpretation of what to the public means, right? Because some of the services are actually benefiting, you know, whether it's aquatic habitat or the environment as well. Now, that's a benefit to the public, but I guess my concern is if the way I have it there, some people may interpret that more narrowly than it should be. So principle number two is focused on defining the level of service. So what level of service do you want to provide? You know, you determine the service, what is the level of service, right? When it comes to rainwater management, you want to ensure that you know, all of your land use and your development maintains drainage patterns prior to development, right? You want to ensure that you've got stream health. These are levels of services that can be brought in, right? And that helps make the decisions on how you're going to provide that service, right? So, I mean, in a very pragmatic and simple way, you know, levels of service for roads, right? I mean, you know, how many potholes per kilometer are you willing to cover? How many potholes per kilometer is your residence willing to put up with, right? There's a cost to make sure those potholes don't exist. You know, how many line breaks in a water main, right? How many service disruptions per year? You know, does every street need curb and gutters and sidewalks, right? There's a cost for providing that level of service. And so it's determining what the level of service you need to satisfy, you know, the, I guess the taxpayers and whether they're paid as well. So with level of service come operation and maintenance requirements over the life cycle of the asset. You know, so you know, one of the things we're talking about today, design of nature, sustainable service delivery, looking at how nature and ecosystems integrate into some of the services. It's you know, it becomes you know, operational maintenance. You know, some of the questions that you have to ask and how does development impact operation and maintenance is answering some of the questions, you know, where it's built. Is it, you know, is the development occurring in the right place? Right? I mean, you know, an example, it's up north, but a small development that is it was 10 kilometers outside of the town. I think it was 37 lots, had septic failure systems, you know, really hard clay, small lots, and on a groundwater system that actually had, I can't remember, some heavy metal, so unable to provide, you know, water and wastewater management services. You know, the solution for them, at least provided us, was you know, connect to the community. So that's 2 10-kilometer pipes. I think the cost ended up being like $75,000 to $80,000 per home. And our suggestion was, well, why don't we just buy all the homes and tell them to go move into the community? That's not what we said, but I mean, you start to understand that you know, there's a cost of buying that capital, but then there's a cost of providing the service and operating and maintaining that asset as well.
So why didn't you say to them?
What did we
why
say?
Why didn't you buy up the house asset? It's less money.
Well,
you're
no, but I mean, the answer for us was, you know, we're not going to fund the project. Right? So you're going to have to find a more sustainable solution. Right? And they did look at some other solutions. There was some industry that was close by. One that was taking water out of a creek and treating it to some degree. So I think they ended up ending up with a partnership to reduce the cost for water.
Just out of curiosity, who had the subdivision control over that property? The province, correct?
Yeah, that probably would be it.
Different silo.
But I just want to get back to it. Actually, that's very important. I run into some situations where that's what I hear. Failing septic systems and the need to connect to a community sewer. You know, Jerry Kempling and Mike Zabarski have heard this from me many times, so don't laugh or giggle when I talk about it. But, you know, a community comes and asks for an extension, one of the things they say is, well, you know, the province put these lots in, you know, you should do something about it. And we say, sure, but you know, we will do something about it to ensure it doesn't happen again, and that is requiring you to put it in the bylaw for lot size, if there's not going to be sewer. And then, you know, all hell breaks loose, right? So, you know, it's, and that's what I'm saying, shared responsibility, right? I don't mind taking the blame for provincial decisions, but then you sort of have to accept some of that responsibility, so if we're going to try to make a solution, everyone's going to play a role. Oh, there you go. So there is, that's the 80-20 or the 20-80 that Kim was referring to, and I mean, that is a general rule for most linear assets, vertical assets. Quite often the construction is between 10 and 15, or as low as 7 or 8. And so maintenance and operation and disposal is actually a larger cost, but the 20-80 split is pretty accurate for as a generalization for most linear assets. So, I mean, one of the things we're trying to do here is try and tweak that circle, or actually shrink the circle, right? So this, if the circle represents the total life cycle cost, how do we make that smaller? And how do we, how can we make the operation and maintenance piece smaller? So what is a sustainable infrastructure or sustainable sustainability? Well, I think it integrates all the principles of asset management. So asset management is talking about primary styles. It's about integrating the different finance, planning, infrastructure, engineering, operation, maintenance. It's also bringing in decision making, right? It understands the value of land use planning and understands the impact land use planning has on service delivery. One of the things that, as I mentioned before, right, asset management quite often isn't really started or it's triggered once the asset is created. And so, you know, some of the assets that are provided through development, you as a local government, you sort of have to look, well, who are going to be taking over those assets? Is it an asset or is it a long-term liability for us? And what role do we have in ensuring that those assets that are being are created through development, meet our needs with respect to long-term life cycle costs and bringing that down. It integrates the design with nature philosophy. I think that's where all that upfront planning and it requires that vision as well. So, recognizing nature is about valuable asset. It must be maintained to operate effectively. Nature's assets often appreciate. You look at rainwater management, and what is the value of a tree, right? I mean, the tree, intercepts rainfall. What does that tree do? It grows, right? So as it grows over time, it intercepts more rainfall. So, think of a national forest, or a forest, and a lot of precipitation actually gets to the ground, opposed to some of the old ways of subdivision where it was strip everything and strip the soil as well. So, how can we leverage nature's assets to help provide a service? And nature provides multiple services, some similar to traditional community services like rainwater management. And of course, with this, you still have to recognize that with the many and many of the resources it provides are finite, such as water. So, what is, so when you're looking at sustainable service delivery, I think really what you have to begin is take a pause, right? Has to come from a long-term vision from the community. What do you want and what do you want the community to look like? And maybe I'm stealing from all of the premises, but it's backcasting, right? It's what are the steps to get to that point? Certainly it needs an integrated approach, and we talked about integration quite a bit, but it shared responsibility as well. And of course, I think, you know, you got to think outside the box or think outside the sandbox, and you got to be prepared to play in the sandbox as well. Everyone's got to be able to play in the sandbox. Anyway, that's it for me.
Stay right there, Glenn. Stay right there.